It's a lot of hard work. Appreciate it. So our speaker tonight is Jennifer Brock. She has been a faculty member in the mechanical engineering at UAA since receiving her PhD from the Ohio State University in 2009. Her specialization area is fluid and thermal systems, and she teaches courses, thermodynamics, heat and mass transfer, and fluid mechanics at UAA. She is currently serving on as chair of the mechanical engineering department. And thank you, Jennifer.
Speaking during this presentation is Rocky Capozzi, who's the director of the Aviation Technology, also from UAA. I'm really happy to be here. Thank you. One of the classes that I teach at UAA is an advanced, it's kind of like a senior level elective in advanced fluid mechanics, and we learn how to model different types of flows, and this talk has kind of undergone some iterations over the years, but it started as kind of a fun applications lecture for my advanced fluid mechanics students, just to show some of the applications of compressible flows. And the original inspiration for this talk was the voiceover at the beginning of the movie, The Right Stuff. So how many of you have seen the movie, The Right Stuff? If your hand isn't up, you should watch it. It is an American classic. But the movie starts with a voiceover. That talks about the sound barrier, and it says, there was a demon that lived in the air. They said whoever challenged him would die. Their controls would freeze up, their planes would buffet wildly, and they would disintegrate. The demon lived at Mach 1 on the meter, 750 miles an hour, where the air could no longer move out of the way. He lived behind a barrier through which they said no man could ever pass. They called it the sound barrier. And that really kind of fascinated me for a couple of different reasons. And one of them was, I had heard of the sound barrier when I was a kid, but I couldn't tell you exactly what it was, what was the actual physical mechanism that caused the sound barrier. And also, we know from hindsight that on the day that the sound barrier was finally broken, the flight was actually pretty smooth. The plane didn't almost disintegrate or fly apart at the seams or anything. And so, what was the big deal? Why were so many people concerned about whether or not it was possible to fly faster than sound? And so that was kind of the inspiration for, looking into that was what, how this talk began. And it's actually a really interesting story. So, but before we get into that, I wanted to talk a little bit about the basis for compressible flow, which is the regime in which high-speed flight takes place. What compressible flow means, it's exactly what it sounds like. The density can change. It's also called variable density flow. So, and that the opposite of compressible flow is, of course, incompressible flow. Because it turns out that for a lot of flows of really good practical engineering interest, the density changes are completely negligible, and so we ignore them, and we model them as incompressible. But as we know, fluid motion tends to be accompanied by pressure gradients. In fact, it's often caused by pressure gradients. In liquids, even if you have really large pressure gradients, they don't change the fluid density much. That's how hydraulics work. And so we almost always model flows of liquids as being incompressible, but for gases, of course, if you apply pressure to a gas, you are going to change its density. It turns out that as long as you're below a speed of Mach 0.3, you can continue to model those flows as incompressible and your loss of accuracy will be negligible. But as soon as you get above Mach 0.3, you really do need to take those changes in density into account. And so please bear with me, but the way that modern fluid dynamics works is we can model the flow field around objects using these equations, which are called the Navier-Stokes equations. And I'm sure there are probably some engineers in the room. Do we have any engineers who took a fluid dynamics class? So the Navier-Stokes equations might still stalk through your nightmares. But these equations look a little bit scary, and they are pretty challenging. But all they are is just the expression of Newton's second law for an element of fluid. And you guys have heard of Newton's second law. What is it?
F equals ma.
Yeah. So all that these equations are, they're just the expression of force equals mass times acceleration for an element of fluid. Over here on this side, these terms represent all the possible forces that could act on an element of fluid. And these terms over here represent the accelerations. These terms here are just, acceleration is the time derivative of velocity. It's how we're kind of used to thinking of it. And then these incredibly ugly looking nonlinear terms here, these incredibly ugly looking nonlinear terms over here are because fluids can flow and change shape. So that's why modeling fluids is kind of inherently difficult. So these equations are very challenging, but they're solving them is within reach of somebody who's got a decent grounding in differential equations and computer programming. And I have my students do some simple incompressible flows as exercises in my class, and these are some examples of incompressible flows. You can see, nice, symmetrical, well-behaved streamlines. Everything's all nice and pretty. So when we allow density to change, stuff gets weird, because the main rule for engineering analysis or scientific analysis is you have to have as many equations as you have unknowns. And if we're using incompressible flows, we've only got four unknowns. We've got the three components of velocity in the x, y, and z directions, and we've got the pressure. But as soon as we allow density to vary, density can be a function of the pressure and temperature of the fluid as well. So we've got to add three more equations. So we bring in conservation of energy, and conservation of energy, these terms here represent the internal energy that's inherent in the fluid, and these terms here represent the heat transfer that can take place if there are any temperature gradients. So now we have to know what the temperature field in the fluid is. Now we have to take into account that the pressure can vary with density and temperature, and the internal energy of the fluid can vary with pressure and temperature as well. And that's when this happens, because there's nobody who can solve these equations by hand. And in fact, it's worth noting that the only way that we can solve these equations is by the most brute force numerical methods possible. You can only do that with a supercomputer. And the computational power to solve these equations didn't exist until the 1970s. So it's worth noting that all of the kind of engineering and aerodynamic accomplishments that I'm going to be talking about today occurred before we even had the capability of solving these equations. And that's not to say that those guys were flying blind. They had very cleverly designed experimental data, and also some really clever theoretical workarounds, but they weren't able to solve these equations until the 1970s. But also the reason that I'm putting these equations up at all is just to show that allowing the density to change seems like kind of an innocent thing, but it's really not. It makes the math explode. So And that's just before you get to the speed of sound. Once you get up to Mach 1 and above, you've got to contend with shockwaves. And so to explain what a shockwave is, if we imagine that we've got a little beeper that's emitting sound waves, whether that beeper is stationary or if it's moving at subsonic speeds, the sound waves are all going to kind of propagate outward. And as long as we're subsonic, the wave fronts, the little circles, right? Those are they're never going to catch each other up because they're all just moving at the speed of sound. And also our object is never going to move outside those wave fronts because you can't catch up with those sound waves if you're moving below the speed of sound. But what sound waves physically are, they're like infinitesimally weak pressure waves. And so if you think about the propagation of sound, not as sound, what's really propagating is information about some event taking place. And so the way, the physical mechanism by which sound propagates, the air molecules are not actually moving, they're just colliding into their neighbors. And they're kind of passing on their energy by this molecular collision. It's like tag, pass it on. And so the sound waves are, the speed of sound is just the speed at which those molecular collisions can propagate. So now if we've got something a little bit stronger than this infinitesimally weak pressure wave, if we've got a body that's moving through fluid at a certain speed, this body has got some kinetic energy and it's imparting energy to the fluid around it. And so what happens is these molecular collisions propagate upstream, and you'll notice the streamlines are starting to kind of bend and change even upstream of the object. That's kind of, when you think about it, that's propagation of information. This body that's moving through the fluid is sending information about its coming upstream of the fluid, and that's happening at the speed of sound. So interesting things start to happen when we move at Mach 1 and above. Because we can no longer send that information upstream, and so things start to get a little bit weird. So if we're just emitting sound waves and moving at the speed of sound, the sound waves don't make it very far before they start to kind of run into each other, and they create this thing called a Mach wave. Now, if we have something a little more energetic than sound waves, like a body moving through the air at about Mach 1, we form what's called a bow shock. That happens, it kind of coalesces a little bit forward of the body and is more or less normal to the body. But literally what's happening is it's kind of like nature saying, oh crap, and hitting the reset button, because we've got distinct properties that exist upstream of the shock and downstream of the shock. And the body is kind of, it's got a lot of kinetic energy and it's imparting that energy to the fluid around it, but that information can't propagate forward because the body itself is moving faster than sound. So shockwaves are really interesting. They're, you can have, depending on the strength of the shock, extremely different temperatures and pressures that exist upstream and downstream. The thickness of a shockwave is about, it's on the order of tens of microns. It's on the order of the separation between molecules. So within one or two molecular collisions, the properties of the air surrounding the body completely change. And if we move at supersonic speeds, with sound waves, we notice that now this thing is outrunning sound, so the wave propagation is going to kind of take place within what's called a Mach cone. And so we've got this zone of silence that exists outside. What the zone of silence is, it's this zone where the air molecules have absolutely no idea what's coming. As we move faster, depending on the speed and the geometry of the object, we can get an oblique shock wave replacing the bow shock. So anytime that we hit the speed of sound or faster, we've got shock waves to contend with. So, and that's actually what the sound barrier really is. It's related to shock waves. The way that airfoils work is, as we've got air flowing over an airfoil, the air we say that it expands over the airfoil. So what that means is that it creates a pressure gradient. We have a region of locally higher velocities above the airfoil and lower velocities below the airfoil. Also lower pressures above the airfoil, higher pressures below the airfoil. That's what generates lift. But the point is we've got this local region of slightly higher velocity. So we don't actually have to be moving at Mach 1 before we can start to flirt with supersonic speeds in this local region just above the airfoil here. So there exists this Mach number. By the way, the subscript infinity is supposed to represent the free stream. So if our free stream Mach number reaches some critical Mach number, and it'll depend on the geometry of the airfoil, it can vary a little bit, then we're going to have a local area where the speed just above the airfoil hits Mach 1. So if we then go above that critical Mach number, we can have a small little pocket of supersonic flow that exists on top of the airfoil. And once that gets strong enough, it will form a little supersonic shockwave. And what happens then is, you guys have all heard of stall in aircraft? That's what happens when the boundary layer separates from the wing. The shockwave makes the boundary layer peel off, and you essentially have a stall condition. So that's actually what the sound barrier is. It's the tendency, you've got this local region of supersonic flow, even before your plane gets to Mach 1, it peels off the boundary layer and you've stalled. And what that means practically is the lift that the airfoil generates goes down, and the drag on the airfoil goes up precipitously. And so that's what the sound barrier actually is caused by these shockwaves. These little local shockwaves that peel off the boundary layers. And the thing that I thought was really the most interesting when I started to look into this was the theoretical and scientific basis for all this stuff was actually really well laid in even before the start of the 20th century when airplanes became a thing. So in Isaac Newton's day, which is, you know, back in the 17th century, it was understood that sound had a finite speed, and actually they'd measured it to pretty good accuracy, and they did that by doing artillery tests where you stood on the top of one hill, you fired a cannon on top of another hill, you measured the time that it took the sound to reach you after the muzzle flash went off, and they actually had pretty good measurements. Newton was actually one of the first people to propose an expression for the speed of sound. He was off by about 15%. Because he assumed that sound waves are isothermal, which means they don't change their temperature as they travel. That's actually not a correct assumption. In 1816, Pierre Laplace derived the correct expression for the speed of sound by assuming that sound waves are isentropic, which means they don't generate any entropy, and that turned out to be the correct assumption. In 1858, Riemann, the same guy who came up with the Riemann sum, attempt to calculate shockwave properties. You know, we'd had some success with assuming that sound waves were isentropic. He assumed that shockwaves were also isentropic. That's actually wrong. Shockwaves do generate quite a bit of entropy. And so in 1870, William Rankine, who was one of the kind of founding fathers of the science of thermodynamics, successfully developed the normal shock relations that we still use today, assuming that shockwaves do generate entropy. And of course, back then they didn't have the internet, so scientific publishing moved at a much slower pace. 3 years later, this French guy, Pierre-Henri Hugonot, and I probably mispronounced that, I'm sorry, independently developed normal shock relations, so they now actually bear both names. Then of course we've got the man himself, Ernest Mach. In 1877, he was the first person to experimentally confirm the existence of shockwaves by photographing them using this new technique called Schlieren photography. And this is the first image that was ever published of shockwaves forming around a bullet. So that was published in 1877. And this is really wild. So, we knew what the speed of sound was, we knew about shockwaves before the start of the 20th century, that's great. But it turns out people actually knew about the sound barrier before the Declaration of Independence was even signed, and this surprised me. And it was because of ballistics. So ballisticians had known about an unusually large increase in drag around the speed of sound since the mid-18th century. And by the way, I think ballistician is like the most badass profession name that I've ever heard. But there was this British engineer named Benjamin Robbins. In 1746, he published some results. He invented this thing called a ballistic pendulum. It's a wonderfully simple device. All you need is a material dense enough that when you fire a bullet into it, it becomes lodged. And so it imparts all of its kinetic energy. And you just have to measure how high the pendulum swings, and you can figure out how much kinetic energy is in the bullet. And he did this with a lot of different bullets, and he found that when they get near the speed of sound, the amount of drag just increases dramatically. And in fact, in 1910, there was a pair of German physicists who published experimental data on projectiles traveling at speeds between 300 and 400 meters per second. The speed of sound is around 300 meters per second, so they came well out the other side. And they showed that the large peak in the drag coefficient on these bullets, it peaked around the speed of sound, and then it started to go back down. So they knew by 1910 that if you could kind of travel through the other side and go really supersonic, the drag would start to go back down. So they knew it was a sound barrier and not a sound plateau. So I thought that was really interesting. So now we're, like we said, we only need to worry about these compressibility effects if we're traveling at Mach 0.3 or above. And for the earliest airplanes, this was not remotely an issue. Like the original Wright Flyer had a maximum speed of like 30 miles per hour. So are you guys ready to see the very first airplanes for which compressibility effects were an issue? These were top of the line biplane fighters in World War I. And their speeds were not even remotely close to Mach 1. But there was a part of them that approached or even exceeded Mach 1. And what was that part?
The propeller.
Yes, the propeller tips. Exactly. So, by the end of World War I, these high-performance fighters, they were flying. They were only flying at like 120 miles per hour, but their propeller tip speeds were meeting or exceeding Mach 1. And British researchers experimentally observed that there was a pretty good loss of thrust and increase in drag that the propellers were able to provide to the plane when their tip speeds exceeded Mach 1, and it was because of the sound barrier. So there was this pair of engineers, Caldwell and Fales. They built the first high-speed wind tunnel in Dayton, Ohio. It was at what was to become Wright-Patterson Air Force Base in Dayton. By the way, if you're ever in or around Ohio, the Wright-Patterson Air Force Base Museum is way better than the Smithsonian. It's like the best. It's the best air museum in the country, I think. I'm from Ohio. But they were the first people to publish high-speed wind tunnel tests on airfoil sections. And these were all airfoils that were used in propellers. The first kind of research into these compressibility effects were for propeller design. And what they found was that there are decreases in lift and increases in drag when you approach Mach 1. They figured out that it was because of boundary layer separation, and they figured out that it was because of shockwaves. They also managed to figure out that the effect is worse for high angles of attack and also for thicker airfoils. So one of the ways that you can kind of stave this off is thinner airfoils have a higher critical Mach number. And that kind of makes sense because flow experiences stronger expansion over thicker airfoils. So, people continue to there was a lot of active research going on in the area of compressibility, and it was mostly geared toward propeller design. And then in 1935, there was this event that was really influential in high-speed aerodynamics, and it was the fifth Alessandro Volta conference. It took place, it was hosted by the Royal Academy of Science in Italy in 1935. And who was in charge in Italy in 1935? Mussolini, and that's actually his picture. I wanted to find a picture of the conference goers, but I couldn't. Mussolini actually, he would have put in an appearance at this conference. He chose this very prestigious scientific conference as a venue for announcing that Italy had invaded Ethiopia in 1935. But when you think about the backdrop in which this conference took place, you know, the Great War had been fought in living memory. There was all this social unrest. You know, the social structures that had existed within the 19th century were kind of being swept away. The communist revolution had taken place in Russia that was making people really nervous. There were European countries experimenting with fascism. The world economy was in the tank. And kind of in that backdrop, there's this really prestigious scientific conference. Participation was by invitation only, but they invited anyone who was anyone. In high-speed flight, they invited Americans, British, Germans, Italians, Swiss, everybody who was actively publishing. The participants from the U.S. included Theodore von Karman and Eastman Jacobs. And you'll notice there are some people on here who've got like theorems and numbers named after them. You know, Ludwig Prandtl has got a dimensionless number named after him. Luigi Cracco is actually the son of this Italian general. That's how the fifth conference ended up getting named, the high velocity flight conference, but he has a theorem named after him. But it was at this conference that one of the most influential kind of design modifications to enable high speed flow was kind of quietly presented, and that was swept wings. Swept wings were first proposed by this guy, Adolf Busmann, as a means of reducing drag, the drag increase and the lift decrease beyond the critical Mach number. And the interesting thing is, his presentation was largely ignored. And if you've ever been to a scientific conference or a trade show, you know that they just tend to be filled with this dizzying array of new exciting ideas. I suspect that it just kind of got lost in the shuffle, but when Theodore von Karman and Eastman Jacobs got back to the US, they didn't even include swept wings in the report that they made. It just kind of got lost. But in 1936, the Luftwaffe actually recognized the military significance of the swept wing concept, and they classified it. Even though it had been publicly disclosed a year before, it was still effective because it had been kind of ignored. And so that's why during World War II, there was the only people who were really doing research on swept wings were the Germans. They managed to produce the first operational jet airplane, which was the Messerschmitt ME-262. And then when the tide of the war turned, the Allied forces started kind of sweeping through Germany, they gathered up all the swept wing data that they could. And the Americans actually gathered up Busmann as well. And there's the story that they kind of came through the door of his office, and he knew that they were there to take him back, and he immediately brightened up and said, "Oh, you saw my talk." And they had to admit that they'd forgotten it. And that story sounds like it's probably apocryphal, but it's a good story, so I've repeated it. He actually went on to become a professor of engineering at University of Colorado. He happily designed swept wing aircraft for the United States Air Force for the rest of his life. There's his picture. And he retired and kind of quietly died in Colorado in the 1990s. So the way that swept wings work, as far as engineering solutions go, it's like the most deliciously elegant solution because it kind of staves off these compressibility effects in two different ways. From the perspective of the air that's rushing over the wing, if the air is rushing over a straight wing, it sees a certain thickness to cord length ratio. If the air is rushing over a swept wing, it has to rush over a longer cord length with the same wing. So from the perspective of the air, the wing seems to be thinner, Remember, thin wings have higher critical Mach numbers. From the perspective of the wing, what's important as far as compressibility effects go isn't the true airspeed, it's the component of the airspeed that's perpendicular to the edge of the wing. And so by sweeping the wings, you make that perpendicular component lower. So from the perspective of the wing, the incoming air seems a little bit slower. So swept wings really are a brilliant way to deal with those compressibility effects. So as far as the sound barrier goes, in the 1930s and 40s, this was kind of the state of knowledge. Drag coefficients on airfoil sections had been pretty well mapped out in this region just below Mach 1. And also, from ballistics, it was reasonably well known above Mach 1 too, but there was this unknown transonic gap. And what I found out is this popular idea of an unbreakable sound barrier actually came from a British newspaper interviewed a British aerodynamicist in 1935, and he showed them a graph that was something like this, and they kind of sensationalized it a little bit and came up with this idea of an unbreakable sound barrier. So that was something that the media kind of got a hold of. I didn't find much indication that the engineers that were working on compressible flight really thought that it was impossible to fly faster than sound, and obviously people knew that it was being done with bullets all the time. The concern was over maintaining control of a piloted craft. And of course, we all know that the sound barrier was broken. I included this quote by Theodore von Karman in 1941. He said, "The aeronautical engineer is pounding hard on the closed door leading into the field of supersonic motion." He said that in 1941. In 1947, the Bell XS-1 research vehicle, of course piloted by Chuck Yeager, flew at Mach 1.06 with no loss of control. So yay. The interesting thing, John Steck, who was a very influential aeronautic engineer, had the idea to create a research vehicle that would fly in that transonic region and generate some scientific data. He had that idea in 1933, and you know, spent all that time convincing people to fund that project. But it's kind of striking how similar the final design was to his initial concept. The Bell XS-1 was a rocket-powered plane. It couldn't take off by itself. It had to be dropped from the bomb bay of a B-29 bomber. The design started in 1944, and this was before the swept wing data was available in the US. So there wasn't any fear that swept wings would be unstable. People just didn't know about swept wings, so they noticed a very straight wing design. But the fuselage was shaped like a 50 caliber Browning machine gun bullet, and that's you know, partly because they knew that bullets routinely flew faster than sound. And then, of course, remember we said that the Germans generated all the swept wing data, and then the Allied forces scooped it up. The Russians were part of the Allied forces at the time, and so they took their swept wing data and they came up with the MiG aircraft. So the MiG-15 was one of the first successful swept wing fighters. The North American F-86 Sabre was the US's first swept wing fighter. It was built to counter the MiG-15. Some other examples of the use of swept wing in designs. The B-29 Superfortress was a bomber that was used in World War II in Korea. Boeing began the design in 1938, so before swept wing data was available in the US. Its first flight was in 1942, and it featured this straight wing design. The B-52 Stratofortress, Boeing began the work in 1946, but it went through two major redesigns. And in the second redesign, they incorporated the swept wings. So finally, the last thing that I wanted to leave you with is, I've talked a lot about military aircraft, and that was, of course, a really important driver for aeronautical engineering in the 20th century. But as far as civilian and commercial use, high-speed aircraft and compressible flow has really redefined the way that we think about distance, just in our everyday lives, and it's redefined what it means to live and a faraway place like Alaska. So just looking at the way that commercial aviation has progressed throughout the 20th century, in the mid-1930s, if you wanted to fly across the country, you might do it in a Douglas DC-3 airliner, and it would take you 17 hours and 40 minutes to get from New York to LA. If you wanted to do it in the 1950s, you could hop on a Douglas DC-7 airliner, and which you notice also still features that straight wing design, and it took 8 hours to get from New York to LA. These days, you could hop in a Boeing 777 or something similar, which does feature a swept wing design. Its cruising speed is about Mach 0.83, and now you can make it from New York to LA in about 5 hours. And of course, no longer in service, but we all remember the Concorde, the first practical supersonic commercial airliner, and that could make it from New York all the way to London in just over 3 hours. So now at this point, I would like to introduce Rocky Capozzi, who's the director of Aviation Technology at UAA, and we can take questions. And I figured probably a lot of the questions are going to be about actually flying, and I don't have any experience with that, but he does. So, if anybody has any questions,
Jennifer, great job. I like your second slide where you have the Wright brothers playing. Why do you have the ground speed instead of the airspeed?
Fair question. Oh gosh. Yeah, fair question. I'm a little bit embarrassed by the answer. Honestly, I added that slide kind of late, and I looked it up on Wikipedia. And you know, that's what made it into the presentation. I was a little bit rushed at the end, but you know, you caught me. Yeah.
What can you? I'm just trying to get my head around. What is the speed of sound in physical terms?
49 times the square root of the absolute temperature in degrees Rankine.
But that's mathematical. What's happening physically at the speed of sound?
So the air molecules themselves are not moving. They're like colliding with their neighbors, because a sound wave is just a pressure wave. It's like a disturbance. It's a little blip. And if I'm an air molecule, I just pass it on by shoving my neighbor. And so it's literally the speed at which those molecular collisions propagate. Is that what you're asking?
And if they're warmer, they can propagate faster.
Pass the mic. Pass the mic when you talk.
And if they're warmer, they can propagate faster. More energy.
And would you repeat the question, please?
Oh, the question was, what was happening physically at the speed of sound?
Yes.
My question kind of follows up on his. Back when I was a kid 100 years ago, I lived by a military base, and they were doing, you know, the flying the airplanes, but you could hear this, what they called sonic boom. So what was happening at that time, and how is it that we don't hear it anymore?
The regulations are more strict these days,
okay.
And you're not allowed to fly supersonic over the continental United States below 35,000 feet or something like that, except in restricted airspace. But the sonic boom is just what you're hearing, is the rapid pressure change from one side of the shock wave to the other. The same way you hear my voice now, it's just a pressure change on your eardrum. That's what you're hearing.
Okay.
Yes.
Talk about the SR-71 and hypersonic lightning.
I can't really. They actually don't. The SR-71 actually didn't get the hypersonic is considered Mach 5 and above. And the SR-71 was around Mach 3. Mach 3 to Mach 3.5. I can't talk to it. It's a cool looking airplane.
Went over 3,000 miles an hour.
Mach 3.5 or so. Yes, over here.
So I read where the Japanese are working on a supersonic airliner that would have a reduced sonic boom. Any idea how this would manage that?
So the question was, he understands the Japanese are working on another supersonic transport that would have a reduced sonic boom. And I think there's also a business jet under development that supposedly is going to have a reduced sonic boom. You know, it's a function of design features and the actual geometry of the airplane, as well as I think the installation of the engines are somehow has reduced the noise. I don't know. Yes.
What does it feel like to fly in that zone?
So the question she asked, which Jennifer anticipated, was, what does it feel like? And I have to tell you, in any fighter from the generation of the F-15, F-16 and forward, it's a total non-event. The only way you can tell is looking at your Mach meter. And so there's a little boop when you go through the sound barrier, a little, you know, disturbance in your pedostatic system. But the flight control laws have been fine-tuned such that there's a huge thing happens aerodynamically when you start going supersonic, and that the center of pressure and the wing drastically changes from about a quarter chord to around 50%. And so what caused all these problems in the, in the right stuff days was the fact that that center of pressure was changing. And the shock wave isn't smooth, you know, it moves back and forth, so it's beating the hell out of the control surfaces and so forth, and that's what was causing all the confusion and the instabilities. But in the modern fighters with the supercomputers they have now, both for transports and fighters, you know, the aerodynamicists are pretty certain when things happen, and they're able to change the control laws as the speed changes. And so you have different control authorities as you pass through the sound barrier. Yeah?
We said before that the drag increases as the square of velocity up and through the sound barrier. So if you want to go faster, take more gas. But then what happens after the sound barrier? If you want to go faster, does it take less gas?
I don't think it ever takes less, but so his question was, once you get going faster than the speed of sound and the drag starts going down a little bit, does it take less gas?
Well, how does it vary?
So, you know, honestly, the subsonic variation is a function of the cube of the velocity as far as power required. I don't actually know. Is there a simple relationship with supersonic speeds, Jennifer?
I actually don't know either. I mean,
you can see the drag curves decrease, and I can tell you this, it's true that, as an example, in an F-16, a clean block 60, block 50, you could stroke the burner, get it going supersonic, come out of afterburner, and it would maintain supersonic speed, low supersonic, but you had to use the burner to get through the Mach. Once you're through the Mach, you could actually come out of burner, and it would stay supersonic. Yes?
I'm hoping that there's no question too stupid rule, because my first
event. Never.
Yeah, okay. But my question is this, we're talking about air travel and supersonic in the air, but you know, you keep seeing people with, you know, these trains that are these high-speed rail systems that increase the speed all the time faster and faster, and I would assume that somebody is trying to increase those speeds just to get people from A to B on a tube or on a train. Is there any work being done with supersonic speeds or with that kind of, you know, when you get that drag at the ground level on maglev rails or something?
I know they do work on the drag is a big issue, but I don't know anything about train transportation.
I was just curious.
I also don't know either, but you would certainly have to contend with the same issues with drag and shockwaves. The only difference at ground level, the speed of sound is different because the density and temperatures of the air is different. But you still got to deal with the same exact stuff.
Okay. You can also do a search on the land speed records, because I know there's somebody that's been working on it, and there's little things like they can't use rubber on the tires because the tires are spinning so fast the rubber would just peel off. so they have to use like titanium wheels. 5 or 6 years, and they might be trying it in the next couple of years to break the speed, break the sound barrier on land.
Yell at us.
The fastest speed an airplane traveled at.
The question was, what's the fastest speed an airplane has traveled at?
I don't know. You know, the X-15 maybe? If you call that an airplane, it's a rocket plane. But I think that went Mach 5 or 5.5 or something like that. But yeah, I don't know what the fastest speed is. Yes, over here.
Yeah, when you see a bullet going through bullet gel on a ballistic gel, makes that temper of gravity. Is that what that shockwave is? And is that being formed around an airplane as it's coming
to the air? I actually, do you know? I don't know.
What was the question?
I'm sorry, the question was when you see a bullet going through ballistics gel, I'm sorry?
Or people,
is it forming a shockwave, and is that the same thing that's happening when it travels through air?
Isn't the gel an incompressible fluid?
Right.
I don't know,
because it's true that the gel is, traveling through gel is really different from traveling through gas, because the gel would be kind of incompressible. So that's a good question, but I don't know.
Do you feel like some sort of plane like the Concorde in the future could be brought back, or some sort of, what would be the limitations or the benefits?
I think the limitations really, it certainly can, they can build another supersonic airplane. It's just a question of how much are you willing to pay for that seat, you know, the economics, and of course, in general, the environmentalists don't like that idea. And it, you know, the faster you go, the more energy it takes. That's a fact. So if you go faster, you use more energy. So I think the, you know, as far as any of the major airlines are concerned, I don't believe any of them are interested in that right now. But I know that there are some business jet people that think that there may be a market there for, you know, the super rich. But how many planes do you have to build to break even? I mean, that was the problem really with the Concorde. So,
can't fly over the land.
Yeah, I mean, that's the other thing. If you can't break the nut on the sonic boom issue, so I guess if you get up high enough, though, it will dissipate greatly by the time it gets, and maybe that's an answer. I don't know. You get up, you know, 50,000 feet or more. Yes, sir.
Do sweat planes just push the compressibility to a higher speed? Is that what they do, the swept wings do, to move the resistance?
It does. So that point at where the drag rise starts, it's at a higher speed before that drag rise starts. Interestingly enough, a straight wing at very high Mach numbers is less drag than a swept wing. But you got to get there first.
Are you talking about over Mach 1 or?
Like, I don't know, Mach 3, Mach 2 plus anyway.
So the question was, do swept wings just increase the speed at which that drag divergence happens? And the answer is yes, but also, In addition to how the wings are fixed to the aircraft, there's also stuff that you can do with the shape of the airfoil, and that's also really, really important, and we didn't even touch on that at all. But you can do a lot with kind of how the airfoil is shaped for how it performs at different speeds.
So
That's an interesting question. So the question was, do we have to go through the same thing once we hit Mach 2? Is there like another theoretical shift that has to happen? There is a shift that happens at about Mach 5. So once you're in, you're in. That's true to an extent. But then once you hit Mach 5, what happened about Mach 5? The way that shockwaves work, they're compressive phenomena, and when you compress a gas, you know, its pressure goes up, but its temperature goes up too. As the shockwave becomes stronger, and the strength of the shock depends on just how high the Mach number is, so as you go higher and higher in Mach number, you're going to get stronger and stronger shocks. Around Mach 5, the temperature starts to get so high that you can no longer assume all of this stuff that I've been talking about is dependent on this assumption, assuming that the gas has a constant specific heat. It turns out that's not a good assumption once you hit Mach 5 because the change in temperature is too great. Once you start to get really high Mach numbers like shuttlecraft reentry, the temperature increase becomes so high that you can actually have chemical reactions taking place in the air. And so that's like a whole nother theoretical quagmire, and that's what's called hypersonics. And there are people who devote whole careers to studying hypersonic flight.
Being Alaskan and a member of the Experimental Aircraft Association, notice you hadn't mentioned the first private aircraft to go supersonic.
What is it?
Spaceship One.
All right.
And they did it going straight up.
Wow.
Whereas the F-15 did it going downhill with full power.
Excellent.
Yeah. Oh,
sorry.
Okay. My understanding is that in Japan, they were having problems with high-speed rail. When they, I can't remember if it was either going into a tunnel or coming out of a tunnel, and it would make this big boom as it would come out, I think it was. And I think they eventually solved that problem by putting a little nose on the end of it, you know, like the pencil on the front.
Smoothing it out.
Yeah, and that seemed to solve the problem. They got the idea from kingfishers. They were diving into water at high speed. Can you talk about what that phenomenon would be when you come out of a tunnel? Why you get that boom?
Not intelligently.
Anybody else?
Military helicopters, you hear a walk, 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 walk. Is that due to a sound barrier from the propellers?
The question was that walk, walk, walk sound when you go to a helicopter?
Yeah, it's not supersonic, it's just a pressure differential. Yeah. How many think that's more annoying than a prop sound? Just curious.
No, 185 taking off is probably going on.
It is, yeah.
Why haven't we seen any commercial scramjets?
Money.
I'd like some.
Yeah. I mean, again, you know, to get the question was why haven't we seen commercial scramjets? And I'll take a stab at it. You got to get to the speed where a scramjet will work. And again, it's phenomenally power hungry to get to those speeds to where that'll work. All right. Yeah, I'm gonna just. Again, outside my experience, but when you get going fast enough, you don't need a compressor section on a jet engine. The air is getting crammed in there so fast that it's already at a high enough pressure to do what you need to do and sustain combustion. So you can dispense with that whole compressor section, which is the front end of the jet engine. All those blades, when you look at an airplane on a ramp, like a Ted Stevens, and you see all those blades, there's, you know, multiple sections of those blades, and their sole purpose in life is to compress the air so they can feed more oxygen into the combustion chamber so you can get more power out of it. And once you get going fast enough, you don't even need those things anymore because the air is going to compress itself as it comes in the inlet.
So what is ramjet then?
It's a jet engine that doesn't need a compressor.
Oh, okay.
Yeah, look at the exhaust on the SR-71.
So, yeah, the engine design's a whole other site. Jennifer could, or actually we could get another engineer in here that's smart about engine design, but it's a whole other lecture in and of itself, just because basically you need to get the engine, you need to get the air as it hits the front of the engine, it has to be subsonic or you got problems. And so airplanes like the F-15 and the SR-71 have variable inlets on them. And so the F-15 inlets, you know, kind of droop down like this, they'll change at different speeds. The SR-71 has these spikes in them, the spikes would come in and out. What they were able to do, what they can do with that, is change the position of the shock wave in the inlet. Remember, Jennifer told you that the air behind the shock wave is subsonic, and so they keep the shock wave from hitting the front of the compressors. And that's one of the reasons why an F-15, for instance, has a higher top speed than an F-16. An F-16 has a fixed inlet. The geometry doesn't change, whereas the Eagle can change its geometry. You may remember what the F-4 looked like. They could change the geometry of their inlet. Yes, in the back.
So since you've actually flown supersonic, when you see the shock wave and it change, you know.
You don't see the shock wave.
So is the refraction, the change?
Nope, it's behind you.
How does that work?
What's that?
How does that, is it just behind you? I mean, why doesn't it?
It's pretty much behind you. You don't see a thing. I'm just going fast. Yes, over here.
That's a helicopter sound, that's a rock sound. I noticed that in my car, if I put one window down, it makes that weird throbbing sound. Is that the same thing as what?
Pressure differentials banging away on your eardrums.
I'm not trying to excuse sound or anything.
No, but it's enough pressure differential to bother your ear.
I can answer that. That's what's called vortex shedding. There's kind of like a vortex that's being generated as your car is driving down the road, and it causes this kind of periodic pressure differential, because it makes this kind of swirling pattern, and that's what you're hearing.
So it's like you have to open a window to hear that, but if you open two windows, it goes away.
Yeah, it's
magnitude may change, but it still bothers my ears.
Oh, it's too. The window on each side, the noise goes away. If you open one window, it makes that sound.
Right here.
Thank you. One last question.
Go for it. How much pressure is on the nose cone when you're approaching the speed of sound, and what was the second part? I'm sorry?
How does it affect the plane?
And how does it affect the plane?
Yeah, I don't think either of us can give you a hard answer to that question. That they spend a lot of time and energy deciding what the geometry of the nose cone is going to look like. Sometimes it's purely aerodynamic considerations. Other times there's a big consideration for the radar that sits behind the nose cone and how much space they have to make for that. But yeah, clearly there is a, you know, that's one of the areas of the plane that's generating drag. Okay. Any resisting force, drag. So the more blunt it is, generally generates more drag. The more streamlined and slender it is, generally less drag. So it's a factor.
Also, it would really depend a lot on how high you're flying, because the pressure decreases as you go higher. So, like, if you're flying closer to the ground, you'd have a higher pressure on the nose, and if you're flying higher up, you'd have a lower pressure.
Okay, I think we're done.